CSS Diner is a fun game where players are tasked with selecting different items on a table using CSS selectors. The game is great practice, but some of the puzzles can be a little tricky. So let's walk through the solutions together. If you haven't played CSS Diner before, I highly suggest saving this video for later and playing the game here. I feel like it doesn't need to be said, but spoilers for solutions coming ahead. Okay, so the first puzzle starts out really simple and we are just selecting elements by their type. We don't need anything super fancy here. We can simply select our desired plate by using its name. In this puzzle, we're doing the exact same thing, except bento is our type. So when we select bento, it is not going to pick up the only plate on the table. Next, we're gonna start selecting items based on their ID. And we can do this using the pound symbol or the hashtag symbol. And we want to select the plate that has the ID of fancy. So by using the ID selector with the ID name we're looking for, which is fancy, we're only going to pick up the plate with that ID. So we're ramping up a little bit, and now we're going to select items that are nested inside of each other. This means that there's sort of a parent-child relationship with these elements. I find it easiest to solve these problems by thinking about them backwards. So in order for us to select the apple that's on the plate, we have to work from the bottom up. So we're going to select the plate first because we have to get the plate before we can grab the apple. So in this puzzle, we're going to use two concepts that we've used so far, which is using the ID selector and also selecting descendants. We want to select the pickle on the fancy plate. So working backwards again, since we want to get the pickle on the plate, we're going to start by grabbing the plate and then the pickle. So we're going to use the ID selector to grab our fancy plate, and then we are going to get the pickle that is on the plate. So we've used the ID selector, and now we're going to start selecting items based on their class name. And it's very similar, but instead of using the pound symbol, we're just going to use a period. So we're looking for small apples, and in this case, small is a class name. So we're just going to use the class selector with the small class name to pick up the small apples. And now we want to pick up the small oranges. So here we can see that we have both apples and oranges that have the small class applied to them. But we only want to pick up the oranges, so we need to specify that type. So just like I've been saying so far, we're gonna work backwards. In order to get the small oranges, first we need to select the type, which is orange, and then we're going to apply that small class to filter down. Next, just like it says, we're gonna throw our back all the way into it and combine a few things that we've learned so far. So we wanna grab the small oranges on the bentos. So we are going to use the descendant selector as well as the class selector. So how can we do this? Let's break it down. So we have small oranges on the bentos. So if we go backwards, the first thing we need to do is grab the bento, and then we want to grab the oranges of the small type, just like the last example. Now we are going to use the comma combinator, which is something very common used when you want to apply multiple styles to multiple different selections. And we are going to get all of the plates and all of the bentos. So in order to do this, we just need to select the types, which is plate and bento, and we're just going to separate these with a comma. And next up is a selector that I don't use too often actually, but it can be very useful. And this is just the universal selector. And since we are selecting all of the things, we are just going to throw that star selector that is going to pick up everything on the table. Next up, we're going to use the selector that we learned about in the last lesson, which is the universal selector. And we are going to combine it with a type selector to grab everything that's on a plate. So by specifying that we want to use the type plate and the universal selector, we're saying grab everything that is on a plate. It doesn't matter as long as it's on the plate. Now we're going to get into sibling selectors. So this is going to be for elements that live next to each other, not elements that are nested or have a parent-child relationship. So we want to select every apple that's next to a plate. So you all know the drill. We're going to select our plate, and then we are going to look for adjacent siblings that are apples. Ooh, just apple. But before we move forward, I just want to call out something really quick. Be careful what order you put them in, because if we were to do something like apple and then look for a sibling that is a plate, we are looking for plates that are next to apples and not what this was asking for, which is apples that are next to plates, even though they sound like they could be the same thing. Next up, we are selecting pickles that are inside of bentos, and this time we're going to be using the general sibling selector and not the adjacent sibling selector like we were last time. And this is going to select all sibling elements that follow it. So when we select our type, which is bento, and we want to pick up the pickles that are beside it, we're going to use the tilde. And it's going to pick up all pickles that are on the same level as the bento. We've worked with descendants, siblings, and now we're focusing on direct children. So what's the difference between selecting descendants versus children? So we can think about this just like we do with normal human relationships. I would consider the plate my grandparent, the bento my parent, and then I would be the apple. So when we look at this plate here, the apple is the direct child of the plate, which is exactly what we're looking for. So in order to do this, we're going to select our plate and then specify that we would like the apple that is the direct child of it. And next up, we're getting into pseudo selectors. So we have a tower of oranges in this case, and we want to select the top one. So we're going to use the first child pseudo selector to do so. So we want to get our type, which is orange, and we want to apply the first child pseudo selector to just get the top orange on the stack. So we have first child, and next we have only child. So in this instance, we want to select the apple and the pickle that are on the plates. And if we notice, because we're talking about plates, both of these plates only have one item. And then we're going to specify that we want the direct descendant of these plates to be only children. So we're going to use the only child, if I could spell properly, the only child selector. So next up, we're going to be using the last child pseudo selector, and we want to select the small apple and the pickle. So what we can do is use their class name, which is small, and combine that with the last child pseudo selector because they're small and they are last in their chain of elements. So we're going to say small and last child. So now we're going to be using the nth child selector, and we get to be selective about the children that we want to pick up. It's going to pick up every n child starting at the top of the set. So we're going to first select our plate, and then we are going to determine that we want the third child, or every third child, but there's only four items here. So the third child in the list. So nth child gives us the ability to select every n child starting from the top of the set, and nth last child gives us the ability to do the same thing, except from the bottom of the set. So in this case, we are looking for the first bento, and if we count from the bottom, we have bento, plate, and then bento. So it's the third one up from the bottom. And it's important to note that we are not counting the oranges that are descendants of plate. So in order to do this, we are going to grab our bento and we are going to use the nth, if I could type properly, last child, and it's third up from the bottom of the list. So we're going to use three. So nth child and nth last child give us the ability to select children based on an amount, but now we can do that with types as well. So we're going to use the first of type in order to grab the first apple. So we're going to specify the type that we want, which is apple, and use the first of type pseudo selector. Okay, now we want to select all of the even plates. So we have nth of type, which is similar to nth child and nth last child. So this gives us the ability to select how many n of a specific type we would like to select. But the cool thing is nth of type also accepts even and odd as parameters as well. So we want to select all of the plates, and we are going to use the nth of type pseudo selector, and we're going to specify that we want all of the even plates. This could also work if you use two, because that is going to give you the even ones as well, but we can use even here. Now we want to select every second plate starting at the third. So if you have a slightly more complex pattern and you need an offset, int of type allows us to have that. So what we can do is actually pass int of type an expression. So let's go ahead and get this started up by selecting our plate because we want to select every second plate starting at the third. And let's go ahead and get our int of type all set up. And we know that we're going to have 2n because we want every second plate. But since we want to start from the third, what we're going to do is add our offset as 3. So what we're going to end up with is something like 2n, not end, plus 3. So what it's going to do is use that plus 3 as the offset. So it's going to say 1, 2, 3, and then at 3, it's going to select every second plate. So now we're going to be using the only of type selector to pick up the apple on the middle plate. And that should sound a little familiar. So what we're going to do is start by selecting our plate. And here we can see that there's 3 plates. We have a fancy one. We have our one in the middle that we're looking for. And we have one with a pickle. Now the one in the left-hand side has 2 apples. And we only want to select the one in the middle. And we can see that that little apple is the only one on the plate. So we can target that one specifically by using a regular descendant selector to just say, we want a plate that has an apple that is the only one on the plate. So we're going to say plate, apple, and only of type to make sure that that apple is the only thing on the plate. So now we want to use the last of type pseudo selector. So we can see that there's 2 oranges, 2 pickles, which we don't care about, and 2 apples as well. So what we're actually going to do is combine a few things that we've learned so far in order to get this selector going. So since we know we want to grab 2 types and we're basically applying styles or grabbing 2 types from the table, we know that we're going to use a comma to grab those 2 different types. So let's go ahead and get started there. And the next thing is we want the last of type for both of them. So we want the orange that is the last of type, and we also want the apple that is the last of its type. And there we have it. And next up, we're gonna be using the empty selector, which targets any elements that don't have any children. And this one will be fairly simple because we just wanna grab the bento, the 2 bentos that are empty. So next up is something that's very useful, and it's the not pseudo class. And it's helpful because it allows us to select based on exclusion. So in this instance, we want to select the big apples. And when we look, the thing that makes apples big or small is the presence of the small class. So in order to target the big apples, we need apples that do not have the class small. So we are going to select our apples, and we are going to use the not pseudo class. And we're just gonna say any apples that don't have that small class attached to them. Next up, we're going to start selecting elements based on their attributes. In this case, we want to select items for someone. Now, when we look here in our structure and we look at the apple, we're using the for attribute. And we have an apple for Ethan, a plate for Alice, and a bento for Clara. And what we're going to do is we want to select all of the items that have the for attribute. So we're going to pull from a few examples ago, and we're going to use that universal selector to say anything that has the for attribute attached to it is what we're going to go ahead and pick up. And now, instead of selecting everything for someone, we are going to be selecting just the plates for someone. So we're not going to be using that universal selector this time. Instead, we are going to use our type, which is plate. And again, we're going to specify any plate that is using that for attribute, go ahead and pick it up. And now we want to get specific. What we want to do is grab Vitaly's meal. I hope I said that right. And Vitaly's meal is on a bento. So what we're gonna do is specify that we want to grab the bento with the for attribute, and we can actually specify a value when we're selecting. So since Vitaly is who we want to pick up the bento for, we're going to specify that the for attribute should have the string Vitaly. And with these attributes, you can specify whether you want the string that you're passing in for the attribute to have a prefix, a suffix, or just contain certain text. So let's start out with selecting items that have a specific prefix. So just like the last, what we're going to do is we're going to specify that we want to select items that have the for attribute. And what we're going to do is use the caret to specify that we have a prefix that we're looking for. So we are looking for any name that begins with SA. And just like I said, you can also specify that you want that attribute to have a suffix as well. So we're looking again for the for attribute, but in this case, we're going to use the dollar sign to specify that we are looking for this string to end in ATO. And if you're not exactly sure whether it's a prefix or a suffix that you're looking for, you can just check to see if that attribute contains certain text. So just like the others, what we're going to do for this last puzzle is we are going to select our for attribute and we are going to use the star selector almost as our wild card. And then we're going to say, I don't know what it begins with, I don't know what it ends with, but I want OBB to be somewhere in the middle. So there you have it. I hope that this was helpful. I love CSS Diner, especially for people who are just, you know, like getting used to CSS and they want to know how to use selectors and have an actual example of ways that they can use them. So I hope that this solutions video was helpful for you. And if it was, go ahead and let me know in the comments below. And until next time, I can't wait to see you all in my next video.